Well, hello, my paranormal peeps, and welcome back to another Deep Woods Paranormal Podcast. My name is Matt Harvey. I am the founder and lead investigator with Deep Woods Paranormal. My wife and I, along with others, investigate everything paranormal in nature. Every week, we will discuss everything from creepy haunted locations to ghosts to Bigfoot, UFOs, Dogman, and other cryptid creatures, and explore all things paranormal in nature. Hey guys, this is Matt with Deep Woods Paranormal. So today we're going to talk about some ghostly things. Right now we have Hurricane Beryl barreling down on us, and it's going to be here in the next couple hours, maybe 24 hours or something like that or less. So we've been kind of getting ready and preparing for the hurricane or tropical storm right now, but it's supposed to be a hurricane. By the time it hits us, it'll probably be a very strong tropical storm. And I think we're going to get quite a bit of rain and some wind and stuff. But yeah, so this will be interesting to see what happens with this. So this podcast might be a little shorter. Again, sorry for the housekeeping, but I just wanted to kind of mention that. So we get asked a lot of questions about ghosts and stuff like that, and haunted objects. Haunted dolls, haunted objects. we'll cover that today. I've also been asked what's the most haunted locations I've ever been to, and by locations I mean multiples. I would have to say the Woodbine Hotel out in Madisonville, Texas, has to be my number one. That place was absolutely insane. Eight entities that were intelligent, that could respond to us right away, answer our questions, interact with us, and basically said our names, and just it was a lot of fun, actually, meeting Ezekiel and all those other entities that were at the hotel. I don't know if they're still there. We have not been back to the Woodbine Hotel since after it changed ownership. We went back there and kind of did a real brief investigation. We didn't really get to hit the whole hotel, and we didn't really capture a lot. So we'll see. Hopefully in the future we'll get to go back there, and we'll follow with that. Down in Brenham, we had a restaurant that we used to go investigate. I think that place was a very close second. Basically, the half the place burned down in the after the Civil War. The owner died there. It was a firehouse. It was a restaurant. It's been it's been many things, but the building's been around for almost 200 years. So it's just a really active haunted location. We experienced a lot there, full body apparitions and stuff like that. If you're watching on our backup YouTube channel here, I might post that over there soon, and then you guys can see that Smitty's Cafe investigations. We actually investigated there for almost 2 years before, unfortunately, the owner had to move because of a dispute with the ownership of the building. So, but great food. If Smitty's Cafe, I think, is still open. If you get an opportunity to go out there and bring them and go have a hamburger or something, please do. It's really good food. And if the owners and everybody are still there, great people. Really enjoyed working with them. So let's see. Other haunted location I've been to. Queen Mary. I mean, Amanda and I have been through, hundreds of locations, businesses and stuff like that. Ships. Of course, Black Star Canyon is very active. I'm iffy on calling it haunted, but it is can be very active. I do call it Shadowland because there's a lot of shadows and entities out there that basically like to show themselves, and they do interact with you. Sometimes they'll light up your K2s, just sometimes get EVPs. Sometimes you'll hear like walking in the gravel next to you. I'll never forget the first time we ever went out there. We didn't have any paranormal gear, really. We just had a flashlight and a backpack full of survival gear. some water, disposable camera. We didn't have much. And man, we saw a crap ton that night. And we were walking and we stopped and you hear ch 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 like something stopped, and we realized we had stopped walking and stopped walking a couple of seconds after we did. And that was just crazy. I mean, everybody had an experience that night. Even the skeptics became believers on my team that night. So, yeah, we all saw the shadows. We all saw this stuff. We had been warned and fell in love with that place. So, unfortunately, I don't live in Orange County anymore, so I don't get to go out there as much as I like to. So that's one of my favorite locations, Queen Mary, like I said. We used to haunt the Queen Mary quite a bit. We were there all the time, like every other weekend, as much as we could be, until we got into helping people in their homes. And once we started helping people in their homes, we basically weren't able to go to the Queen Mary as much as we wanted to. We used to go like every couple, 3 or 4 months, but we used to do it between the Whaley House, the Queen Mary, I can't, Black Star Canyon, San Juan Capistrano, down in Old Town, San Juan Capistrano. There were so many places we went, but and then we stayed in several haunted, said to be haunted hotels, that were basically very, very interesting, but we really never had too many crazy experiences. The Queen Mary, we did. But other than that, we really didn't have too many crazy experiences. Okay. So have you ever been touched? Yes, unfortunately, yes. I don't like to be touched. I've never liked to be touched. I always tell them my rules are you're not allowed to touch me. There's some people that are okay with being touched. You know, maybe it's a validation for them that, okay, yes, something's here. But, I mean, most of the time it's just been playful. Unfortunately, and I'll talk about this in a minute. Yes, I have had scratches, burns, bites. You know, when you deal with the other side of the paranormal, the darker side of the paranormal, unfortunately, that happens. Let's see. What are cold spots? So the scientific theory behind cold spots is basically what happens is when something pulls energy out of an area, it leaves a cold spot. So basically manifestation of a spirit, maybe they're trying to form, maybe they're trying to use that energy to create a voice on the audio recorder or video recorder, or maybe they're trying to show themselves in a picture or on the video camera. Maybe they're trying to move something. Maybe they're trying to make a noise, whatever. They need some kind of energy, so they pull it out of the air. And the theory behind that is that they leave a cold spot. And basically, it's just an absence of energy. When you have cold spots, there's not a lot of energy there. Okay, let's see. Is my house haunted? Currently, this house, I would say this room could be actively haunted because there's so many different haunted objects in this room. You got the dolls. You got the possible picture. Let's see, there's a razor that's also has an entity attached to it. The right here, oops, right there. I've gone through all these before, guys, so if you guys want to go back and listen to the podcast or watch the podcast, you can do so. That dragon has something attached to it. What else is there? There's a lot of stuff over there. Let me turn and look real quick and I can tell you more. Let's see what else is. Oh, the binoculars up there, sitting right by the angel up there, that has a woman attached to it. Let's see what else over there has attachments. I can't think of what else is over there. There's just too much over there. That picture definitely has some kind of energy. But most of the dolls seem to have some kind of energy to them. They seem to have some kind of attachments. And of course, we've lost animals over the years, and they're in their cremated up in their little boxes up there. So Mr. Moo, I think, is still roaming our house as well. I think I've seen him a couple times since he passed away a couple weeks ago. But I kind of think I've seen a dog too. I might have seen Farley a couple times. I have not seen Allie, unfortunately. But we do have into the other entities that do come into the house. We had the German guy that shows up on our podcasts every once in a while. If you guys watched the last podcast, you heard that pop. There was no pop. There was no whatever noise. And then a male voice came through as I sit here. That was not me. That was not my voice. That was totally an EVP. I think it said hello or something, which is cool. Now I'm getting the goosebumps. So somebody was very happy about being able to say hello. One of these days, we'll do another sequence with the dolls and all the items over there with the spirit box, or I'm sorry, the ghost box, and let them have a voice. We do have a new little doll that my friend gave me that does seem to be very haunted. Might as well just tell you the quick story. I brought her home, left her in the car for I don't know how long, oh, 2 or 3 days. My friend had given it to me, and essentially a lot of people from my work listen to this, so I don't want to name any names. But I brought her in, not thinking, and I put her up here. She's actually up right back here somewhere. I think she's right next to this doll. And she's hard to see. She's smaller. She's not very tall. She's only about 6 inches. So she's either on this shelf or that shelf. I can't remember. Oh, she's right there. She's right up next to there, right there. She's right there, right behind Allie. But I think she kind of panicked when she first got here. And so we don't know the story behind her, but I'm starting to wonder if she committed suicide or was murdered. And maybe she just attached herself to the doll. We'll have a conversation with her at some point, and we may record that and let you guys see what if we experience anything. Maybe she, I don't know if she's going to be able to come through or not. But I was in the kitchen, and I turned quickly to my left towards the dining room, and there was somebody hanging from the ceiling. This house is only 5 years old. We built this house, and to see somebody hanging from the ceiling, just there and then gone. It was a little girl. She was just gone. And I went, oh crap. And then my friend from work basically told me that it had been manipulating his dreams and stuff like that. And now Matt is having some strange dreams as well. So is it malevolent? No, I don't think that doll is malevolent at all. I think she's just scared and doesn't know how to interact with people yet. And we'll work with her, and we'll get her to the point where she's hopefully more comfortable and feels more safe. And we'll get her to the point where maybe she can communicate with us, maybe on a more regular basis, and the rest of the dolls as well. And we'll get them to the point where they all feel comfortable talking to us and stuff like that. So, but yeah, we've seen an Indian woman here when we first moved in. She was looking in the mirror and then disappeared. I could see her clearly. I could see the little girl hanging from the ceiling too. That was creepy. Creepy and upsetting and frustrating and a whole lot of things all at once. That had never happened before until I brought that doll into this house. So I'm pretty sure it was her. There is negative energy that tries to get in every once in a while, of course, to mess with me, just because of all the cases I've done against them and all the homes I've cleared. And I'll talk about that a little bit more in a second, because that was one of the questions somebody wanted me to answer. But we do have spirits that come through from time to time. I mean, some of the little kids' spirits that are attached to the dolls do come into our room at night, and they kind of walk around. And I've told them I have specific rules for these dolls and the entities, any of the entities attached to anything in the house. You're not allowed to harm anybody. You're not allowed to scare anyone or the animals. You're not allowed to do anything to harm anything, break anything, damage anything, whatever. And I told them that we'll give you a line of communication, and you will have the opportunity to communicate with us and tell us your story and tell us what's going on with you. And if you do need to, we will cross you over. So yeah, I mean, there's just a lot of entities that do come through, and from time to time, We have seen this is a channel where basically I don't want to get into religion or anything like that, but it kind of does go hand in hand with what we do. So I'll kind of generalize. So if you hear me generalize and say positive or negative entities or whatever, this is because I don't want to push anything on anyone. So just understand that this is not a religious channel, but it does the paranormal and religion, especially when you're dealing with ghosts and sometimes with other things, it does go hand in hand with what you're, what we do. So I just want to make sure everybody understands that. If you don't believe or you're not religious, that's great. Like I said, positive, negative energy, whatever. If you're a believer, you can take it out. Please take it as what it's meant to be. You can put whatever religious terms in there you need to put into there. But anyway, sorry to go on a rant. So yeah, we do have all kinds of entities that do come into the house. They come and they go. This place is, I would not consider this house haunted. We do have things move on their own, apparitions, voices, sometimes disembodied voices, as you've heard if you've listened to the podcast before. Sometimes I highlight some of the EVPs that come through. Sometimes I leave them just to see if people will comment down below, "Hey, did you hear that?" At this point in time on the audio clip, there's this. If you guys are commenting on one of the podcast platforms, because we're on 60 plus platforms, we don't always see your comments. So if you want to email us all of our information, my cell phone number, my email, our website, everything's right there down in the description of whether you're listening to the podcast or you're listening or visually watching the podcast. So you can please, send us a comment that way. If you're on YouTube or Rumble, either channel, go ahead and leave a comment down below. But if you're on any of our audio podcasts, do me a favor, just text me, email me, call me, whatever. We've had a whole bunch of people come through lately and start sharing their stories. And it's been so amazing to hear everybody's stories. Bigfoot, UFOs, alien abductions, dog man. We've heard a bunch of stuff. It's been really fun to listen to you guys and really interact with you and hear your stories and be able to drop a pin in the location you guys have had the activity. So again, sorry for the rant. I just got to get that out there. So again, please don't be afraid to leave a nice comment, please. Remember this channel is PG rated. We try and keep it for all audiences. So please don't leave negative comments down there. If you want to leave a negative comment, again, my cell phone number's there, my email address is there. Send it to me privately and I can talk to you later about it. But like I said, just keep it positive in the comments if you would. And 99.9% of you guys do that. So we really appreciate that. And we appreciate it when you like and subscribe. So helps us out. Okay. Do animals see dead people? I get this question a lot from people. I believe some do and some don't, or maybe they're not as bothered. Shorty, the little Doberman-looking dog that we should see here, I don't see him anymore. He ran off in the room. He definitely sees people. He freaks out in the middle of the night. He will go hide in the bathroom and won't come out. And he sits there and woo, woo, and he'll wake me up. And I get up and I look around. It's 2 o'clock in the morning. I'm like, I'm tired. I'm trying to sleep when I'm here. I'm like, okay, there's nothing. I don't see anything. But he's telling me there's something here. And so I'll look out into the hallway, into the dining room, and I'll see movement go to the left towards, like the family room area. So yeah, I mean, he does definitely see things. I think Zeus, our second littlest one, sees him. Tink doesn't seem to be bothered that much. Allie, who unfortunately is gone, she definitely saw dead people. And we'll go talk about that in a minute here because that kind of goes into my next couple questions. Have I ever lived in a haunted house? The house when we lived in Lake Forest had two very strong, maybe actually three very strong entities. What we found out as we were leaving that location is that that location used to be a farm. And the farmhouse actually was on the property about, I don't know, 100 yards away from where we lived. And so there was a strong male entity, a very positive strong male entity, a very strong female positive entity. There's a that's Zeus right there. Like I said, he's one of the ones that sees the dead people. And then there's a little girl, and she was interesting, very intelligent. All of them were very intelligent, could interact with us and stuff like that. But yeah, that house. Again, I wouldn't, yeah, I would say it was haunted. It was haunted. Yeah, definitely. We recorded footsteps. We recorded a shadow in there. We recorded balls of energy, or orbs, as people call them, plasma, essentially flying through and flying into things like the TV and other stuff. It was really weird just to see it look like Slimer without the slime. But yeah, that house was definitely actively haunted, and those dogs, those animals, Farley didn't really react to them, but Allie sure did, and he would bark. She would sit there and bark, bark, bark. There's some homeless stink helping out of there. She would bark, bark, bark from the kitchen back into the mud room, and she would not come out one day, and I had to go pick her up and carry her back in. This is about a 70-pound dog, she's chocolate lab, so yeah, I mean she would. She saw stuff all the time, and she wasn't very happy about it. But Shorty reminds me of Allie a little bit, so I don't know. Maybe Shorty's Allie reincarnated. Who knows? Okay, haunted dolls. Explain. Yes, I do collect haunted dolls. I stayed away from them for what 40 some odd years, and never really collected them until about 3 or 4 years ago. No, it's about 2 years ago, actually. I think I started collecting them, yeah, about 2 years ago. I got my first one and was really interesting and wanted to communicate with her. And then slowly but surely, we started going to garage sales and yard sales and the Goodwills and stuff like that. And then pick them up and I go, no, she doesn't have any. This doesn't have any energy. And, the more I'd kind of pick up different dolls, it was like, oh yeah, this one has energy. And some of them, unfortunately, they had some negativeness to them. And we don't bring negative things into this house unless it's for an emergency. And at that point in time, that will be put in a very secure location and dealt with in a very secure way, so that does not end up doing something that I don't want in this house. Because I don't want anything happening to my little guys. That's Mr. Binks up there. But anything happening to the animals or us and stuff like that, because I've dealt with that. I know that can happen if you bring someone like that into a house. So I've been very careful with all these dolls up here. And I've really screened them. They all seem to be different personalities. Some are nice, some are just kind of laid back, some are just kind of watchful. This one here, oh my gosh, we'll have to bring her down one of these days, and we'll have her, you guys watch her eyes watch you. It's the craziest thing. She just seems to be like more of a watcher. She watches everything that goes on. I think she's pretty happy. But there's some other dolls up there that are more a little bit more mischievous. Now the Howdy Doody doll is not mischievous. He's not even in He's not even haunted, or it has have doesn't have an attachment that I know of at this point, but most of the rest of them up there do. So yeah, I don't think I'm gonna collect too many more haunted dolls. I just enjoy them because I think they're kind of interesting. And at this point in my career, I wanted to try something different. When you've done as much as I have, and you've been to so many haunted locations, and you've experienced so many things paranormally. I just wanted something. I wanted to try something new and see. You know, I've heard a lot of people say they've had really good success with haunted dolls, and they've been able to communicate with them and carry on conversations, and befriend them and kind of get to know them. And my religious people on here are going, "You're nuts. You're crazy. What the hell are you thinking?" So yeah, I know. I know. I'm sorry, but I'm gonna get a lot of crazy comments in the comment section down below. Well, so anyways, that goes along with haunted items. I think that razor That old razor has definitely has an attachment. I know that the dragon does. We got that. The gentleman had just passed away, and that's a really cool dragon. I've shown it before. Again, you guys can go back and watch those videos if you don't remember which one I'm talking about. But yeah, I mean, almost all that stuff up there has some kind of attachment. Now, a lot of it doesn't. It's kind of mixed and matched. So the top shelf is not the top shelf. The top shelf is the dolls and the animals. Second shelf down is basically a lot of the haunted items. Excuse me, I can't talk. And the third shelf is definitely haunted items and stuff. So I will get it better. We just ordered some new lighting for under there. I had some lighting for under there that lit up, and unfortunately, they didn't last very long. Unfortunately, we got lights that didn't stay on for very long. Middle of the podcast, they would just go off. But anyways, almost everything on that shelf kind of tells my paranormal journey, if you will, starting from like ghost hunters and all that fun stuff. So, okay, have I ever performed an exorcism? Yes, I did. I walked into it not knowing I was going to be doing it. I've talked about this many times before too. Called in a priest to help somebody. Was just there mainly going to be an observer, and didn't think I was going to participate at all. I'd never really read up on exorcisms or done anything, had anything to do with them. And so the whatever that entity was extremely strong. And I'm pretty sure I know who it was now. But as I was sitting there, I mean, crazy crap. I mean, from the angels appearing behind him to his face turning black to his voice changing to the room going to freezing cold in the middle of the summer to the priest walking out on us because he got scared and handed me by his Bible and said, "Here, just continue to read this and you'll be fine." And 2 hours later, I had to end it because I didn't, we were almost there. We were almost there. And we had to end it. It was just go too crazy. And so essentially we went to finish it off. We were supposed to finish it off, I think, the next night, and then they disappeared. The guy and his girlfriend disappeared. So not sure exactly what happened, but I definitely, while I was doing the exorcism, I definitely had visions of things that he had done, and they were not good. I'm not going to go into them, but anyways, yeah, it was the first and last, hopefully, I will ever have to perform. Maybe in the future, I'll be better prepared, but I don't really like that. After I did that exorcism, oh my gosh, I now have a target on my back. So I'm constantly under attack from things that I can't see, and it's a little scary, but I'm used to it now, and I'm more focused, basically more well protected. So they really can't do too much to me. But yeah, demons do not like me. So do I bless homes? Yes, I do bless homes. I go through and bless them. And if you're in Texas here and you're going, "Oh my gosh, I need his help," and blah blah blah, and, or "I know somebody that needs his help, how much does he charge? How much does all this cost? And what's the fee for doing all this?" Guys, we don't charge people. If it's a case where we have to travel more than about 2 or 3 hours to get to you, we might ask you to help us out with a little bit of gas money or something. Maybe make us dinner when we get there, or if we stay the night, maybe you make us breakfast or whatever. But we don't charge for our services. We basically just, we're in it for the research. And so I mean, I've been doing this, God, 30 some odd years now. And we've never charged anybody for anything. We've gotten donations from people that wanted to help us, and we were very grateful. Paid for our gas, paid for new equipment, helped us get into locations, stuff like that. But we don't charge for our services, and everybody has, everybody can basically help each other. As I always tell people, just pay it forward. If we help you and you have an opportunity to pay, help somebody else, then please do. So, what did I experience as a kid? What got me into the paranormal? Let's see. This is kind of a tricky question. I didn't really want to get into the paranormal. As a kid, I started out as just seeing spirits like they were you and I. I couldn't tell the difference. I had no idea what was going on. Growing up in a Catholic home with a dad that, you know, isn't into the paranormal, isn't into ghosts, didn't really believe. Essentially, it was very hard to explain what was going on, what I was seeing. And yeah, so I don't know what when I stopped seeing them as like solid people, but it had to be around my between six and eight, and then it basically got to the point where they started antagonizing me, and like opening and closing closet doors, pulling pillows out from under my head as I was sleeping, trying to pull me off the bunk bed from the top bunk of the bunk bed. If you've seen the movie Sixth Sense, or he has a sheet fort and some silhouette walks by. That's happened to me. I totally experienced that. And then cold spots and shadows darting around the room. And then as I got older into my teens, I essentially started to experience full body apparitions again here and there. And basically started to, I was just terrified of it. I didn't know what to do with it. Hearing them talk, I could hear them talk, especially as a kid, the whispering. The stuff you see on movies, that's I've experienced that. It's real. At least to me it is. Some of you guys are going, God, this guy's nuts. But yeah, I mean, those are my experiences. I can't change them. I can't tell you they're not real. To me, they're real. So, you know, I know we have both sides of the spectrum on this channel. We have believers, non-believers, and people on the fence. So, like I said, you guys got to experience things for yourself and make up your own minds. Don't let anybody else make up your mind for you. I know you guys come on here to listen, to hear my stories and stuff, but you guys really have to experience those things for yourself. So, yeah, as I got into my later teens, the tormenting pretty much continued. Basically they constantly scared me. And when we finally moved to a place called Laguna Hills, my dad built the house, and as we were building the house, this crazy stuff happened. Stuff, you know, not to me, but to the workers that were building the house. Things would move on their own. Things would disappear and reappear in different places. They come back and find things rearranged and stuff like that. And then as time went on, we moved in, and the house just had this heavy, thick feeling to it. And I started basically trying to figure out what's going on. I had friends come spend the night, and we'd see things or experience things like footprints coming through the ceiling. And essentially, they would never come back. We'd hear walking up in the attic, and my dad basically built that house, you know, with every last penny he could put into it. He screwed the floorboards down. He also glued them so that house never made a squeak. I mean, that house is beautiful. And unfortunately, my parents lost it because, you know, the economy fell apart. But so, yeah, I mean, that house was very oppressive. Scary crap happened. I mean, I'd spent a lot of time by myself in that house where things would happen. Like, things sound like something was banging around in the attic. And the dog, that was Ashley. We don't have Ashley's ashes here. But Ashley would look up at the ceiling and start growling. And so essentially she would just start growling, and then boom, 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 boom. And finally got to the point where I started going up into the attic with my dad's old Handy Cam, you know, big VHS cassette tape, video recorder. And some of you are not probably old enough to remember what that is, but look up VHS Handy Cam and you'll see how big that thing was. It basically sat on your shoulder, and, you know, some of you are. And then he had a little cassette tape because he used to dictate for his secretary. And I went up there one day and recording audio and just by myself, nobody in the house, just me in the attic in the pitch black, you know, being stupid, trying to figure out what was going on. And what was I, 19 at that time? And so essentially, yeah, I got some kind of voice on there and I switched out my dad's cassette that he had recorded for his secretary for a blank tape. And he comes running into the room the next that Monday morning. He's like, "What's this?" I'm like, "What are you talking about?" And he was holding the recorder, audio recorder. I'm like, "What?" He wouldn't tell me. He just shook his head and walked off angry. And so there must have been something pretty interesting on there that basically, yeah, I mean, he, yeah. And I had a lot of scary experiences in the house. That house was, I hate to use the word, it was negatively haunted. Let's put it that way. Amanda experienced things too. Other people, a lot of people experienced things that shouldn't have happened in the house. Then when I basically met Amanda in high school, our senior year of high school, I was scared out of my mind that day. And I called her and she, you know, getting by myself in the house for the weekend. And she comes over and she didn't come into the house, but she told me, "Come out, talk, let's talk about it." She calmed me down and we looked up and we literally saw the blinds, the wooden blinds go like this, like something just like peeked out. You could see something standing up in my brother's room. And I'm like, "See, I'm not going back up in there." And she's, "Well, you got to go face that." And she's, you know, she grew up with the paranormal too. And so she's like, you gotta go face that. You gotta face that down. And then that's when my, you know, I slowly but surely with her help turned my fear into curiosity. And then from there, basically got into where I am now. So that was, God, what was that? God, 30, yeah, almost 30 years ago. So, yeah, I mean, just crazy, 29 years ago. But, yeah, I mean, that's basically when I started. And then we basically got into ghost hunting. When Ghost Hunters came on, we were already basically, when we started dating, we started going to, like I said, when I first started this conversation, we started to go to explore different haunted locations, the Queen Mary, what is it called? The Whaley House in San Diego. We go up to LA. We would meet with different people and stuff like that. One day somebody goes, "Hey, you know, you should," they saw the show Ghost Hunters and they're like, "That's what you do. You should do that." And so I'm like, "Yeah, that's interesting." So I started finding other people that were more interested in becoming, sorry, I think it's starting to rain. I found more people that were interested in essentially doing what I was doing, ghost hunting and trying to figure out what was really going on. And the more I did the research, the more I kind of got hooked. And we started helping people in their homes. And we became the California Ghost Hunters. And then we became a Topps family member team. And then we were just off to the races. 30 people. We had almost 30 people. We had people answering phone calls. We had people. We had three different teams. Sorry, stinks being loud. Three different teams going out to three different locations on Friday and Saturday nights, and then basically turning around and delivering the evidence, if we had any, back to the clients. And we debunked like 99% of the stuff, but we still ended up with some stuff sometimes. And so we helped, you know, thousands of people, and we were just going, going, going. I did that for what, 13, 14 years. And then I just, pretty much everybody on my team basically burned out, and I burned out too. So come here, Tink. Yeah. But yeah, so then basically I went off on my own, started doing tours of Black Star Canyon, San Juan Capistrano. We started going up to the Suicide Bridge up in Pasadena and the Grand Canyon Caverns, and then basically I kind of recruited my friend Chris, who had been on a tour with me, to continue with me. And then I gave it to him after that. And then basically we left California after that. But then we moved here and we weren't going to do any of this. and we were going to kind of change our focus mainly to Bigfoot research. But then essentially we started getting calls for people. We had left cards at people's businesses and they started calling us. And so we went out to check out their location, and sure enough, we came across really cool people, really cool locations, and we got right back into ghost hunting. But we also do a lot of Bigfoot research too, and we do UFO research and stuff like that. So the more I do the research, the more interesting it gets, the more questions I have, and again, especially with Bigfoot and UFOs and stuff like that too. I'm very careful with my UFO research and the cryptid research too, like dog man and stuff like that. So I've heard a lot of bad stories about dog man, but who knows? I mean, they could be as docile as Bigfoots. They could just have a bad rap. So anyways, guys, I appreciate you guys listening. I appreciate you liking and subscribing to the channel. God, I can't talk. It's about time to get out of here. So yeah, if you guys want to leave a comment down below, tell us about your story. If you want to come on the channel, please do. Please send me a message. Either text me, email me, call me, go on our website. All this is down below in the description, and let us know. We've had a lot of contact with a lot of you lately. And we're so grateful for you guys that have come forward and told us your stories. It's been a lot of fun to hear you. We were supposed to have someone come on and talk about their alien abduction stories, but unfortunately, I think Big Brother's messing with my computer because I couldn't get her onto our platform for some reason to record the show. So that's why you guys are sitting here listening to me rumble and stuff like that. So anyways, you guys stay haunted, and hopefully, we won't be blown away by this hurricane. And we'll be back with you guys next week. All right, you guys have a good one, and we'll catch you on the next one.